I'm Eva Meszaros with Specialty Food News, and I am joined today by the great Barbara Corcoran, businesswoman, investor, real estate mogul, and obviously from ABC's hit investment series, Shark Tank. Welcome, Barbara.
Pleasure to be here.
Did you have a particular interest in specialty foods or even just the business of food before you started investing in some of these businesses?
You know, I honestly didn't have an interest in anything other than real estate before I went on Shark Tank. And as you know, we see so many different businesses there. I think I didn't know I had an interest in food until I started looking at my portfolio and realizing it's 80% food. How did that happen? Okay. But now, looking back, even though I didn't intentionally do that, I think I like people who like food, and that's a big piece of it for me. I like to cook. I love to entertain. I'm not even a good cook, but I cook anyway. And I feel like people who like to feed people are happy people. It's my own little stupid theory. And so the entrepreneurs that come on the show that are pitching food products, I tend to like them all. I don't think there's one I've met that I didn't like, and I can't say that about all the business people that come on. And so I like the people, so one foot's in the deal, and then the only remaining question is, do they have something unique here, something that could sell that I could make some money on? But it starts with the people, and I just like food people. That's it.
What's the first thing you look for in a company you're considering investing in?
You know what I'm always looking for is something that's different. Because there's really nothing new out here in any space.
Yeah.
It's all been done before. So the best you could do is do a new twist on something old. So I'm always trying to figure out, okay, what's the twist here? That's number one question. Do they have a twist? And then the number two question, which is probably a far more important part, is this person capable of hitting the finish line? Because it's so easy to start a business like it is to have a baby, but it's so hard to raise a kid. And business is the same way. And you're going to have the good days, the bad days. You're going to have the teen years, or the equivalent of. You're going to wonder why you dare even give birth to the kid on a bad day, right? And so I really need to know that I've got a great parent there that's going to take care of that business, going to push it and love it, not just this year, but 3 years from now, bad times and good times. And if I judge the person to be that kind of person, they are always going to be the kind of person that succeeds. They always succeed because they have that kind of persistence that's at the core of anybody who's going to be successful. Persistence, yeah.
Are there any challenges you see as unique to food businesses in trying to attract investors?
Yes, definitely. You know, if we get on Shark Tank, a technology business, even if it's not a great technology app or anything, there's always the quiet promise that you might make a killing, because this thing that you're only investing $100,000 in, that little piece of stock could be worth millions one day. Now, does it really happen? I haven't had one. Okay, but with a food business, it's a long haul. Anybody in the business realizes it takes enormous patience to build the network of buyers who are going to buy, to cash flow your own product on the shelves of stores, to hope not for returns, to be able to stay with it. It takes tremendous endurance in the food business. And what is particularly curious to me each and every time I invest in a food business is the person who invented the product invents it out of love. It's their love child. They love it and they believe in it. And that's good in that it gets you a business. It's bad in that it's naive. So once you're really in the throes of building a business and trying to get on store shelves and handle the cash flow and all the free merchandise you wind up giving one way or the other, you realize what a long haul it is. And so it's good that you're stupid enough to get into it. But it's bad in that the surprise is it's much harder than it looks. You know, so I have tremendous respect for the endurance ability of the entrepreneurs that are really plugging away and making a go of it. It's just not an easy business. It's underestimated tremendously. Yeah.
What's the one thing a company can do to turn off an investor?
Oh, there's lots you could do. Okay. The phrase I least like to hear, and I hear it a lot with people with food products, okay? I won't be happy until I see my Wheaties on every store shelf across America. I'm like, oh, God, I'm out. It's lovely to hear this, okay? But then the follow-up question is always, okay, what's your plan? Oh, people just love my product. I'm out again. So that kind of inability to articulate how you're going to make it happen is terrible for investors. Because remember, they lose their money when there's no express plan that can be executed. The money's gone. You know, you're not going to figure it out later. If you're coming to me for my money, you better know how you're going to do it, because it's my money that's going to make you do it or enable you to do it. And so to be able to articulate a plan as what you're going to do first, who your audience is, your likely customer, what are your margins, can you get your numbers down, how much cash you're going to need to see it through the stores, do you have to buy the shelves, about having that kind of ability to convince me you know what you're doing is key. Because remember, I didn't have the love child. I might learn to love the product, but I'm not in love. I'm the stepmom. And you got to convince me that this baby is worth my love, which my version of love is the money, right? And my effort and my time. I love minority positions, okay? For this reason, if I'm a majority shareholder and I'm not running it day to day, I mistrust my partner. Why would they be motivated? They're working for me. No, I want to be working for my partner, right? Okay. So a minority position is good for me, for my position, and it's also good for the entrepreneur. You know, we're all in business for ourselves for one reason. We want to be in business for ourselves. The last thing you want to do is work for the next guy, or you wouldn't be in business for yourself. I had 22 jobs before I started my real estate company, and I hated every one of them. I did a great job, but you know what I hated? I hated somebody telling me what to do, all right? That's what gets you in business for yourself, to be the lead dog, to build your own universe, to do exactly what you want. Good, bad, and different, it's yours, right? Okay. So if you're looking for shareholder, you only want a minority part. You're a pushy guy, I could tell. You're also a little bit of a pain in the ass, I could tell. Yeah, because you're very specific, which is a good thing, okay? So you want a minority partner, yes.
Thank you.
Pleasure. I have a little experience here, most of it negative, I'll share with you. All right. First of all, I don't think there's a limit to a handmade product. I think we all live in a world right now that people cherish that. Okay, so it's a premium product is what it is, right? For example, Daisy Cakes, who makes all of her cakes by hand, including sifting the flour by hand, a lengthy process, and sells her cakes for, I think it's $50 a cake, an 8-layer, big, juicy, homemade cake shipped direct to you. Right? She actually was able to sell thousands upon thousands more than she was doing at home when she took it to a commercial kitchen. Still handmade, okay? But somebody else was hand-making it, all right? And she was able to really expand her business tremendously. However, it took three kitchens. The first two ruined her product and almost put her out of business. Returned cakes that she never had before. All right. You know, most consultants I find, my brother T, who's in business for himself, including 8 of my 9 siblings, believe it or not, are in business for themselves. My parents must have done a number on us, okay? But he has an expression for consultants. If anybody's a consultant, don't be offended. And maybe you've heard it, but I never heard it. He said, they borrow your watch to tell you what time it is. So that was a good one, right? Okay. But the consultant will tell you their job is to be an editor, a negative eye to tell you what won't work. Remember that. That's the perspective. That's what they paid for. Your job as the entrepreneur is to trust your instinct and march forward. And so I'm not saying you don't get bad advice. It's useful advice to resize what you're doing. But you must believe that you can do exactly what you want to do, because it's from that belief that you actually wind up creating an empire. It's a God's honest truth. It's not magic juice or foofy thinking. It's what gets you there, right? Let me just say to each of you here, I'm assuming most of the people in this room are in business for yourself and are working a small business in the food space. Good for you. It takes such courage. Don't you feel sorry for everybody else who really wanted to do it and never tried it? And, you know, even if, you know, I had another business before real estate and I failed miserably at it, it was flowers. And I love flowers. I still do. But it was a hobby, not a business. I didn't know it at the time. But let me tell you, I'm so thankful I tried the flower business, you know? So the pain of failing at something is nothing compared to the pain of having a regret of not trying. The saddest people in the world are the people who wish they should have, could have. Good for you for having the courage to stepping out and doing it, right? Rah, rah, rah. Okay.
Great words to end on. Thank you, Barbara, and thank you, everyone, for attending.